Okay. All right. Another part of this is that this is not just informative, but we want at the end, we want everybody to bring up their concerns, their questions, and everything that comes to mind when they start to see and learn about Gutenberg, which I'm going to talk about. So, show of hands again, who's heard of Gutenberg so far? Okay, who's actually used it in some way? Okay, so a good amount of people. So we're going to talk about, we're going to kind of boil it down a little bit and figure out what are we trying to do? So what is Gutenberg trying to solve, and how did we get where we are today, and where are we going? So, a few challenges for you as I go through my talk. I sent all of my challenges to Johannes, and he approved them. So number one is to block out the noise. So if you have been paying attention at all, there's a lot of opinions out there. There's a lot of bad reviews out there. So if you go to use Gutenberg, you might say, oh man, you know, usually I'm told to look at the reviews and gauge whether it's a good plugin or not, right? Well, this is a little bit different. So this is a substantial change to how WordPress is going to work. And it's also not done yet. So it's out as a plugin to allow as many people to test it and use it as possible. But people are taking it as a finished product sometimes. They have very strong opinions about changing the editor. So it's important to zone this out for tonight at least. And we want to consider those opinions, but we want to form our own opinions first. So that's number one. Number two is consider perspectives other than your own. So what would you call yourself?
I call myself a user.
A user, okay. What kind of user? Are you a photographer, a developer, a designer?
I use WordPress to communicate out to the world.
Okay, perfect. So when I talk about perspectives, WordPress is approaching 30% of the internet. And so that means there's all these different types of people that use WordPress. So me, for example, I am a developer. But I work every day with designers and content editors and all these other people, and their uses of WordPress are always different than mine. And they think of things that I would never think of to make happen or that is a need. So even if you're one of these people or not one of these people, we're all just types of users. So we want to kind of remember that is we want to put our position, put our mindset as somebody just using WordPress. But that could be very, very high number of different types of people. So, number three is to get involved. So, it's a very young product right now. So, there's plenty of room to jump in, help out, submit issues, do some user testing. I don't know who said it, but things are built by the people that show up, and decisions are made by the people that show up. So, if you show up and you have an opinion or an idea, it might get in. So that's an important part to all of this. It is no stupid question. So at the end, you have a question, it doesn't matter what it is, let's talk about it, let's address the concern that you have, and we'll go from there. Alright, so what is Gutenberg? So we're gonna get to that. But as I said, we want to understand what we're trying to do. So what problem is Gutenberg trying to address? So Gutenberg is an attempt to fix the editor. So at the State of the Word in 2016, Matt Mulloway announced that there's going to be a little bit of a change to how WordPress was built. So WordPress used to be released every 3 or 4 months, but there was basically whatever tickets got worked on and whatever features were ready got put in, and then we shipped fairly regularly. So that was going to change. So with that change, there's still currently that way today, is there's three focuses. The REST API, the customizer, which who's used the customizer before? Okay, awesome. That's seen a lot of great improvements this year. And the third one was the editor. So when you hear the editor, most of you probably think of this. And when you're just writing your content, this is actually really, really good. It does a really good job at that. This is the distraction-free mode, so everything gets hidden and you can just focus on your writing. like I said, that's really great. But when we start to think about, here we go, being really great. When we start to think about what WordPress is today, it's not just about writing things anymore. It's 30% of the web, right? Enterprises use it, people use it for very, very complex things. And it's a very, it's basically a CMS platform now for many, many people. So this is more accurate of what the editor actually is. When you edit something, there's a lot of things that are considered. There's categories, there's tags, there's images, there's your excerpt, you know, whether you have comments, and all of these things might affect how your content is displayed on the front end. So there's really a disconnect of this to what actually is presented to the user, right? So that's one of the main problems that is trying to be solved here. And furthermore, as we start to get into the more details, so a location, a category location, so if a post has that selected, it might be presented entirely different than an uncategorized post. You know, maybe it's a different color or it has a map associated with it. And likewise, the featured image. So again, these are two things that you can configure and it might drastically change the way your page is presented. But there's no indication of that in the admin area. Pages and now other post types have page templates. And these again, these will drastically change how your page is laid out. So in this example, we have a no sidebars template. So that's going to make your page basically full width. There's going to be no widgets on the page. And that's a big difference than if you have a sidebar and you have your archives listed on the side. But again, there's no indication of what this actually does on the front end. You can change this all you want and update it, and it's actually completely different. It's not what you want. There's some other problems in WordPress. There you go. Yes, my problems. So here are some other examples of problems, and we're going to revisit each of these three, and we're going to see how they're fixed in Gutenberg. So the first one is embeds. Does anyone know what an embed is? Okay, very few people. So an embed is it's actually just a standardized way to share content from your service or your website. So if we take YouTube, for example, YouTube is an embed provider. So if you take a YouTube URL and you paste it into WordPress, WordPress knows how to take that and turn it into an embed. So the editor is really great because these are supported by WordPress by default. But there's a lot of tricks to it. So sometimes if you have an extra character at the end, or if there's a span tag around your URL, if it's not on its own line, it won't actually embed. And a lot of people get really frustrated by that. But it's a step in the right direction, right? Because we're actually seeing a preview of what it will look like on the front end. So this is kind of a step in the right direction. But a lot of people don't even know this is here. We had like three hands come up, right? And that's no fault of your own. It's just, it's really a developer feature that not many people know about. Another problem is, who has come up with this great design, and then your users completely screw up what it was supposed to look like, and you have to go in and fix it all, or you know, train them over and over again, or they get a new employee, yeah. It's a mess, right? So the things never look how they're meant to look. So this is a wireframe from our new BU Dining site that we're working on. And you can see we have all these different elements. We have our address, our map, we have our time to open, other related locations. So this is a lot of information. So now picture you're a new employee and you're coming to the website, and there's a new location on campus somewhere, and you have to populate the page with all the data. So this is what it looks like right now. So we use CMB2 a lot, and we organize things as best we can, but there's just a lot of data here to be able to enter. So you can see how this can be very overwhelming for some people, and it exponentially increases the issue of there's a disconnect of, hey, how do these actions, if I click this, What is the repercussion of this on the front end? What is this going to change? And we can make educated guesses, but ultimately, we're going to have to try and find out. So this is what that translates to on the front end. So you have our hours, you have how you can pay. And some of this is automated. Some of this comes in through different integrations with services we have. The menus comes in automatically through different services we have. But this is a lot. And this, you would never be able to tell that this is what this is going to look like. So again, you can see the huge disconnect here. Another example, I just built this plugin for our internal use called BU Banners. And so we had this really old plugin that was really not that good anymore for content banners. But all that you do was pick an image or put in a handcrafted HTML snippet. So we do a lot of linking in our headers. We have a lot of needs for titles within our banners and stuff like that. So this was our attempt to make it much more flexible and just do more. And we can replace it with different things. So this is what we came up with. So we have, you pick your image, you choose your banner type, and you can add or remove fields, which wasn't possible in the old version of how we tackled this. He loves it. But again, still, we still have to update the page and come to the front end and see what the reflection of what we've changed. So out of the box, this is a great tool. We're going to use it on a lot of our sites. And the users don't really need any instruction or training to really use this. It's pretty intuitive. They can make good guesses and construct their banners. But they still have to have those two windows open, or they have to save it and check it out. So again, step in the right direction, but it's still missing a little something. So where are we today? Enter Gutenberg. So Gutenberg is all about turning all of your pieces of content into this. It's like the matrix. A block, okay? So a block is any piece of content in your editor. So if you take the editor, and we're gonna see what Gutenberg looks like. So that's a paragraph block. So even paragraphs are just blocks. And the blocks can be turned into new types of blocks. So now it's a header. There's a quote block, and there's tons of great default blocks that are built in. The Gutenberg team's doing an awesome job of building really cool stuff. So now this is a demo page where if you install the plugin, you can edit this and see, it kind of shows everything that Gutenberg can do at the current moment. So we can see here, as we change the different options, we're seeing a reflection of what it's going to look like on the front end. So that's really great. This is a really great way to preview that without having to jump back and forth. You can sort, if you see the arrows on the left, you can sort your blocks up and down. This is a really minimal example too. If you check out the state of the word for 2017, there's a good about 15 or 20 minute demo of that Matthias did, who's one of the leads, and it shows a lot more than this. So I definitely recommend going checking that out. All right. So remember the embeds we're talking about. So this is how embeds are handled in Gutenberg. Each one is a block. And you can see the difference here. It prompts you for exactly what you need, and then it embeds it. But at the beginning, you can see that it also lists all the other embeds, all the ones that you didn't even know were there. So now it makes people more dangerous because they have more tools at their fingertips, and we can add to those with custom blocks. So imagine all different things. So maybe we have, if we go back to our menu, our dining location example, maybe we have a block for the map, or maybe we have a block for the hours of operation. And that would allow us to give fields that would directly correlate and show a preview, and then the user can more accurately predict what's going to happen. So what about meta boxes? So who's built a custom meta box before?
Hello.
Okay, a few people. So meta boxes are those things on the page with the fields and the options where you, so say you install Yoast SEO, right? There'll be some fields for the page title, the description, and all those things. Maybe you put in Jetpack, there might be some for galleries or other features like that. So, another example, we also saw the BU Banner meta box. That was a meta box. So if we look, it actually still works. But it doesn't look the best, right? So meta boxes will still work, and the team is doing a really good job of making sure support is still there. But as you see here, this may not be the best way to do this anymore. So as a developer, we're going to be reviewing a lot of these different tools that we've built to see if there's a better way. So this is really rough, but this is kind of what I envision BU Banner's becoming. Is similar to the cover image, right? But we have our set banner layout options, and an improvement on this is we might be able to let them have multiple banners throughout the page, whereas right now we can only have one on the current page. So again, super rough, but shows you an idea, gives you an idea for how your current tools and meta boxes might translate into blocks. So think about this example here. We have this wireframe again. You can start to see the flow of things, and now imagine that each of these things is a block, and there's no restriction onto where in the page it can go, right? But then say we have a location and we want everybody to start with this, with this structure. So building this out every time would be very difficult, right? So there's actually something called block templates for a post type. So when you create a post, this is an example of a book. So you can see here there's a title, there's a spot for an image, and then there's a spot for the author and a description. And when it's filled out, it would look like this. So these are going to be really great to give guidance to the users. Because when the user gets there, if it was just add title and start typing, it's really overwhelming. Like, oh my God, what do I do? Like, how am I supposed to make this show up and look really great? So this will really help us, help you to guide your clients or your customers. Let's think of another example. Maybe you have an event, right? You could have a spot for the date. You could have a spot for the location. You could have a map block in there where you put the URL for Google Maps. And you could have an open bed if you wanted to have a video. So those are good things about Gutenberg. And there's many, many more. I want you to go and try it out. There's a great tool called Frontenberg, which is basically Gutenberg, but you don't have to install it anywhere. You can just go and just use it. And so that way you don't have to put it on your site yet if you're not comfortable and you don't wanna have to deal with any of that. Well, let's talk about now the things that we're afraid of. So Gutenberg is new, and obviously it's still a work in progress, but there's anytime something changes so drastically, and this is a major, major change, there's always going to be things we have to really think about and talk about. Alright, so keep track of your fears. I want you to write them down. So, one for me. I'm a developer. I have to learn a new language or a new framework. So this is primarily a React app. You could use Vue or another JavaScript framework if you're more comfortable. But I am not the strongest with JavaScript, so I definitely have to buckle down and sit down and start to learn some more JavaScript. So that's definitely a big deal because your organization might not have someone that knows React. And so what happens there? How many people do you need to learn React? How many people do you need to actually learn JavaScript that don't know any JavaScript? Existing sites. How are existing sites going to behave when Gutenberg is activated, when versions are core, right? So Gutenberg stores everything in HTML comments. So if you know how you view text on your editor right now, it would actually be HTML comments. And the comments have data so that the React app knows how to render it and what properties to give it. But it also has a markup stored in that comment. So there's a freeform block that you can basically put content in. And that might just be how your content is converted. So it's definitely something that you'll have to sit down and step by step, you're going to have to really look at it. How do your short codes convert? How do your paragraphs convert? So it's definitely something that you would want to audit, make sure that everything's going to go smoothly. You don't have anything in there that might cause some problems. Your existing plugins. So the Beam Banners example, how is that going to work? So you can see that it would still work, but it might not look the best. Maybe you have WooCommerce installed. How is that going to translate when you activate? That's a very complex plugin. And maybe you have plugins that haven't been touched in 3 years. Is that going to work once 5.0 comes out? So these are all things that people have to think about. Is it worth parting with that plugin now, or is it worth keeping and dealing with? This one's a big one. So the documentation and training. Who here has trained a client before about how to use the editor in WordPress? Okay. So now, we're going to have to do that again. So you might have this guide that you always use to train your clients and onboard them once you're done with their site. And that's going to change because this whole flow is going to be a lot different. It should be a little bit less because we're getting rid of that disconnect of what you're doing in the editor and how it's going to appear. But there's still going to be a learning curve for that. That's it. That's all I have. We're going to turn it to John. And John is going to talk about a business perspective of this is coming out. They have all these clients that are on Gutenberg, and what do they have to think about as they move on?
Thank you. Great.
Okay, so we should be live now. Good? Yeah, sounds great. Cool. So I didn't bring my wireless clicker, so sorry if you see me using my machine. But I want to talk a little bit about the agency perspective of Gutenberg. The first and most important thing that I'm telling every client and every agency that I deal with about Gutenberg is don't panic. Everybody relax. We're all in this together. It's a community. We're trying to make fundamental major changes to how WordPress operates. There's going to be a lot of fear and anxiety. There's going to be a lot of things that people are freaked out about. Especially those of us who work in agencies or who work as freelancers who work on WordPress all the time need to not panic because the users are panicked enough. And so if the developers and designers can't get their heads wrapped around what's going on in Gutenberg, I don't know what the users are going to do. So from my perspective, one of the sort of key things that makes me excited about Gutenberg is there's a challenge in the world of technology about how to do disruptive design in an open source project. So if you're a commercial software maker, you make Sitecore, you make Adobe Experience Manager, or you make something like that, you decide you want to change how the software works. You pay 100% of the people who work on that software. It's a relatively small team. You have perfect control of them, as much as anybody ever has perfect control of their employees. But you can literally tell them what to work on and what to do. And technically, you can force adoption on your users in the sense that they either have to upgrade to the newest version or they become unsupported, right? come to Windows XP. In the open source world, it's very easy for communities of open source teams to do incremental enhancements, to build on what they have, to make small changes. It's very hard to take a large community through a disruptive change like Gutenberg. So some of this is a little bit of, if WordPress is going to stay competitive with other software platforms, and that includes the people like Sitecore and Adobe Experience Manager, but also the smaller sites like Wix and Squarespace and other kinds of editors that exist in the world, we need to be able to do some of the kind of disruptive changes that those companies can do more easily, right? And Gutenberg is, I would say, probably the second of the major of those changes, the REST API being the first. So at TenUp, we're super excited about Gutenberg. It's WordPress's opportunity to continue to win the battle over author and editor experience. Every time I've worked with other content management platforms, every time as an agency owner or operator, I've had to go in front of a client and the first time show them what the backend is going to look like of their Drupal 7 site or their Sitecore site or their Adobe Experience Manager site. We're all scared to death because the first time they see it, they're going to hate it. The second time they see it, they're going to get it. The third time, and eventually they'll get accustomed to it. And it's kind of like Stockholm Syndrome. They're willing to appreciate how it operates. But WordPress is the only platform I've ever worked on where I don't have that fear. I'm perfectly happy to jump on the demo with a client at any point in building the project, at any point in selling the project, even before it's a project, because people really like to work in WordPress. Content authors and editors recognize the WordPress interface. They know how to make it work, and it works well for their use cases. Except in the places where it has been running into trouble over the last 3 or 4 years, some of which Tom highlighted. So why do we need blocks, right? We talked a lot about sort of getting out of the single page compose model and more into decomposing the page into blocks. I want to talk about two quick case studies of things that TenUp has built over the years that show you kind of how these blocks are used by actual editors. These are not built in Gutenberg, to be clear. This is work that we built before Gutenberg existed, right? But it shows you some of the kinds of things that we do. So this is Microsoft InCulture. It's microsoft.com/InCulture. It's where they talk about their partnerships. These are the kinds of pages modern editors want to build. They alternate between one column and three column and two columns. Sometimes things are aligned right, sometimes things are aligned left. This one's actually a carousel, right, which has multiple entries in it. It has the knockout on the right-hand side. There's an option that has it on the left-hand side. They're bringing in other stories, they're going to four column, they're having a pull quote with an image aligned right and a pull quote with an image aligned left, right? They're making lots of different kinds of content. How do you do this in the pre-Gutenberg world? Well, you do it with post-meta, right? These are less elegant maybe than some of the screens John was showing. But basically, you end up editing text in little lines and boxes and making choices from layouts like this in a way that don't actually show you what those things are going to be like. In their case, under fragments, they can also collapse and expand, and they can at least drag and drop to reorder. But we're doing this custom every time, right? Microsoft uses this plugin on a couple of different sites, but it's a Microsoft plugin. Another site that we built in the last year is a company called OnDeck Financial. They connect small businesses to financing. Again, you see, I didn't put the timing delay on that one. These little stripes like decisions in minutes that have step one, step two, step three. Call-outs about who certain loan specialists are, so they have a bunch of different ones of these with different pictures and different names and different locations. Testimonials like these, either aligned left or aligned right. Lots, and then calls to action like ready to unlock opportunity. Those calls to action might be different on different pages, right? Having, in the absence of a block editor, you don't want an author having to go into WordPress and edit HTML in the HTML editor version because they don't know HTML. They create things that are non-performant. They create things that don't translate well into responsive. These aren't page templates in the traditional sense because they're going to vary too much, right? There's one page template and then there's a bunch of different variations that happen within it. So in their case, we use something called Shortcake, which is a UI for shortcodes. So basically, on that editor page, I click Add Post Element, and I get this giant mega mobile. I get a choice of all of these different kinds of things that I can enter. Once I choose one of those, I'm in a second modal following the first modal, I make a bunch of choices, and then ultimately I enter. Or I load the page in visual mode, and at least we're showing a little bit of a preview, right? So it's not quite like the banners where you have to first preview it to see it. We're showing in the editor what the shortcode renders as. And there's that little box at the top that has the pencil icon in it. I click in that. In order to edit what's in the shortcode, I'm back in this view. So that disconnect between I'm looking at this, I want to click right there and edit that thing, right? Because I've used the web forever and that's how it's supposed to work. I'm supposed to be able to just click on the thing and edit the thing. And instead I've got to click that little button and get in this mode and then make my choices here and then save them and then look at them in that other mode. Like, it just doesn't make any sense. That's how the web works. So those are the kinds of things that we think blocks might do. We thought also about some other things that blocks might do. So we work a lot with media and publishing clients. Very, very commonly in media and publishing clients, you have ads, right? Because that's what actually pays for the site. Very frequently, you have in-content ads. And you play this interesting game about there will be an ad after every third paragraph, unless that's next to an image, in which case it'll be after the fifth paragraph, unless the paragraphs are too short, in which case it'll be after the seventh paragraph. In Gutenberg, we can treat ads and ad units as themselves blocks. So here's an example of like an auto-inserted ad block. As the editor is typing content, the editor in this case has no approval over where ad units appear, but they can at least see where they're going to appear, so they can avoid this weirdness where you write a really short paragraph and then you have this massive ad. Instead, they can kind of bulk up paragraphs and sort of see what that experience is going to be like. Or, and some of our clients are experimenting with this today, we can actually pre-insert the ads already filled out as blocks. And then what we'll know is those are the ad units that have been sold for that page. You can fill in content around them. I know some of the journalistic purists in the room are thinking they're now writing content around ads. As one of your famous assistant journalists are people who scribble on the back of advertising. So what else might blocks do? This is where I think we get really excited, is thinking about all the kinds of things that you see in web content that you interact with on a daily basis and how those can be blocks. So yes, OEMs, yes, maps, yes, calls to action, yes, links to related content, what we often call recirculation modules, right, that get dropped in and pull automatically from the taxonomy to show you other things. But thinking sort of across the board of how am I now composing a page from smaller elements, because that's what actually pages are made of. So our advice is to get started now. We started at the turn of the year saying any new significant build project that TenUp is doing is using Gutenberg by default. And if there's a reason why the engineer doesn't want to use Gutenberg, they need to come justify it to myself and the president. There's just no good reason to be continuing to go down this custom build path without recognizing that this is the path that WordPress is going to go down. So I encourage all of you who are not developers and are not designers, start playing with Gutenberg, whether you're using Frontenberg, so right now Gutenberg is a separate plugin you can download and install on top of your site. It's not been merged into Core, you don't need to run some weirdo development version of Core, you just install the plugin and try it out. The plugin will be able to be turned off on certain kind of post types or for certain editors, right? So you're not gonna get sort of forced into using this day one, but it is the direction in which WordPress is going. And instead of all of us continuing to build our own sort of custom solutions to this problem, this is the direction in which the community is headed. Because we'll have a more common way of doing this, it'll be a lot easier for us to do things like accessibility in the editor, right? This is something that the Gutenberg team has pushed really hard to make sure that blocks are highlighting ways in which content is accessible and also making themselves accessible. Instead of having to do that across Shortcake and Microsoft Fragments and Content Blocks, which I talked about once before in this meetup, way of doing that, we'll have a standard core way of doing this kind of thing, and we'll have one place in which to iterate on an NPM. Cool. So I think Mel's gonna also talk a little bit about some design, how you design blocks, and design considerations for block makers.
So are we doing questions?
Do you want lightning or HTML?
Yeah.
Can't do either. Can I use your laptop?
Yeah, that's fine.
Are you learning a different
I'm trying to learn
keyboard? I think I might be able to use it even with the
keyboard. Arrow keys are in the same place.
So if you're looking just for an introduction to Gutenberg, you can go to wordpress.org/Gutenberg. It has a lot of information both about the project, and then at the bottom there's a bunch of handy links. A couple posts that have been written with some possibilities in them. I just want to talk quickly about some of the design principles around Gutenberg and designing the block. So, let's see if we can make these bigger. So this is the kind of the anatomy of the new editor, which is what we're calling it. It's a little bit outdated, but for the most part, it still matches what's there. You have an inserter button. Right now, this is in kind of a different location.
Keep pointing.
Yeah. Pointed stuff. Whoop. Okay. So now, when you make a new line, you'll still have an insert button. On the right here, you have your sidebar. It's split up into two tabs: the document tab, which is information about your post and page. So if you're writing a post, that would be your text and categories. You're making a page, that would be your like page attributes. Some of your published settings, whether something's private or public or password protected. But the big thing is the block tab. So when you select a block, so one of these, and then go over to the block tab, you get a bunch of different options depending on the block that you've selected. So that's kind of the new like advanced configuration for blocks. So let's look a little bit at the block itself. So the block gets an outline, so you know that you've selected it. There's a mover, and rather than the setting the delete now, there's a kind of an ellipsis menu. And so that gives you a bunch of different options, like either converting it to a different kind of block, deleting it, making it reusable because you can share blocks across posts and pages. And then up here, you have the formatting tools. So for example, the paragraph, you can switch between paragraph and heading and list. So like blocks that are grouped together can be switched between each other, just for convenience. Alignment, and then any sort of additional formatting. Each block kind of gets its own inline tools up there. The quick toolbar, that's what it's called. So let's see that in action on front and back. So as John mentioned, John number one, this is kind of like a live demo of Gutenberg. So if you want to play around with it, but you don't not necessarily want to install it on your site, you can just go and like poke around. So here you can see the toolbar. It's different depending on the block that you're editing. For example, if you if you're on an image, you also get like image alignment. Let's insert something. So you have the inserter over here. These are two recent blocks that somebody has used. So this is my favorite shortcut, is the slash menu. If you've ever used Slack, it's a chat app, you know that you can do slash and then an action. You can do it on, I think IRC is the same way. I haven't used IRC since Slack. And so this is really awesome because you can do slash, and then let's say you want a paragraph. You just start typing paragraph, boom. So it's just a really quick shortcut. So if you know exactly what you're building, you can just quickly slash command, add a block, and then keep writing. And so, clicking over on the block tab. So looking at the image, it takes full text. So. It's really hard to type on a
I'm
keyboard.
I'm testing your memory. Of
yeah,
your
no, I feel like I'd be okay. His keyboard is a different layout than QWERTY. So yeah, Isha, you can see in the block tab that it changes based on the kind of block that you have selected. I want to go into templates a little bit too. So you could also define templates currently for your custom post types. So this is a custom post types for books. Custom post type for books. It takes a book title, a featured image, or a cover image, really, for the book. The title and then description of the book. So if we just delete all this content really quickly. You see a placeholder now for each of them. So if you're making a custom post type for your clients, that means all they have to do is fill in the blanks. So add the author, the description, the title. And it just makes it much better than just having a bunch of meta boxes or just one empty text editor. So this is another example of e-commerce. So product image, price, description, and so these you just fill them in.
Can I just ask a quick question about SEO? So you know, like right now, Yoast, you would be able to put in some of your information for optimizing a page. Where is that going to fit?
So Yoast has been working on a solution that works in the sidebar over here, and as well, they've been mocking up some inline. Ideas. So they recently wrote a blog post about how they're planning on integrating. So here is a tip that they're putting in line on the sidebar. I think for the most part, it's all there.
So just different location, basically.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, and they've been really active about developing for Gutenberg, so they're really ahead of a lot of other plugin developers right now. Oh yeah, and an idea for some tips that are almost like inline comments, so they'll highlight the text and then pop up over here. They have a lot of really cool ideas. And I've seen a couple plugins kind of with the same ideas of really getting something done by the time 5.0 is launched later this year. WooCommerce has a couple things going on right now. I'm wondering, I don't have access to it. It's on my computer. Yeah. So if you are designing a custom block for Gutenberg, there's a couple things you'll want to keep in mind. Figure out what font is going. So let's say name something custom you make for your clients.
Oh geez, on the spot.
Anyone else in the room? Hey, let's
staff profile.
Staff profile?
For like their organization.
Okay. Would that be like a page?
Like a custom post set, is that what you mean? Or are you looking for a functionality?
I'm thinking about functionality.
Social sharing block.
Okay, that's a great one. Social sharing block. It's something that you see in a lot of different pages. So in that case, what you might want to do is design a block that in the block settings, it takes different social networks, and you can add which social network you want to display in there. It's probably something you want to have be a shared block. So we're working right now on kind of extending shared blocks beyond just like here. So So converting to a reusable block. So now, this is Coda's poetry. Okay. So it's not letting me save it because it's a demo. But you can actually like say a block is reusable, and then you can just drop it into any other page or post that you want. So I see like a social icon block being a reusable block that you can use. Maybe even like declare that it should appear on every single at the bottom of every single page on your site, which is something you'll be able to do in the future with Gutenberg templates.
Do you have dynamic blocks there too?
Yeah. Let's look at the reusable block.
Who uses widgets?
Widgets?
Yeah. This is great because widgets are blocks. So every core widget is now a block as well. And they're dynamic.
Yeah. We're in progress. But they will be. So widgets are probably not going to be converted into, not all the widgets. Some of them are done, some of them aren't done. Probably most of them aren't going to make it into 5.0, but they'll make it into 5.1. Mm-hmm. So for example, so this site only has one post, so you can see one post. But it shows kind of your latest posts, so you can say, I want to show 10 latest posts just from one particular category, and you can choose newest to oldest to newest, A to Z, whichever. You can say when it was published. So now you have the date. You could display it as a grid, so you can't really see it now because there's just the one. But when you have multiple ones, rather than displaying in a list, you'll get a grid view. We're going to be working on adding featured image support. So if you ever see somebody's homepage where you have like three featured articles on the homepage, you could do that using this block. So you just drop it into any page that you want. So now rather than having to either custom code a template and like writing your own loop, or using a short code, you just drop a block in. And so it'll make creating really cool custom home pages especially pretty easy. Yes?
Can you do tabbed?
I imagine somebody will make a tab block. That seems like a really good idea for a tab, and also or idea for a block, and also something that you see a lot in short code plugins, or included with themes. So somebody will make that soon.
Can you tell us what the URL is again? I can't find it.
Yeah, so you can see it up here. So it's frontenberg.tomjn.com. If you Google Frontenberg, you'll also find it pretty quickly.
You just have to know how to spell Frontenberg, which
yes.
is kind of
true.
Fronten Berg.
Tomjn is.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Can you wrap text around an
image with blocks? So that is a work in progress, having inline images. I have to see if it was done already. No, not yet. Okay. But that's one of the features that's going to be in the bridge. It's just one of the leftovers that hasn't been finished yet.
But you can float an image, yeah.
Yeah, you can float an image, but you can't wrap it. So. Take this one. I mean, I guess it doesn't wrap, but you can't put it inside of the paragraph like you can now, which is good in a number of use cases. But yeah, you can float it like a regular image.
There's also going to be a way to insert groups of blocks, right? Where you
can
have in the block selector with insert columns, like three columns with images and text.
Let's see if that's in here. Yep.
Ah, yes.
Yeah, okay, cool.
So you could have whole sections that they can insert into their page with all the components, much like when you create a new post and it has the image and the title.
This will use your default font, whatever you set.
So like themes are now, you need to declare support, which is just, I think, there's like an extra style sheet that you can remember. It should be really similar to how it is currently.
Yeah, so we're kind of getting into the open floor part. So yeah, if you have thoughts about what you're seeing, if you have questions, just speak up and yeah, so go ahead.
So with the testing, what have you found when you use Gutenberg on a site that's got a builder on there, like Elementor or Beaver, Divi, you know, something like that? Is it completely broken with something like Divi with the short codes? Or?
So I know that Divi's working on support right now. But in most cases, you can't, it doesn't try to load the page builder in Gutenberg yet. So,
because I'm just thinking, I'd like to try the plugin, mm-hmm. turn it on, and just see what's there,
yeah.
and then turn it off.
Mm-hmm. Right, so it's not going to block rendering of pages if you haven't edited them, right?
Yeah.
So they're going to keep rendering just fine. When you make a new page, depending on what the current version of Divi is doing, it may disable the Gutenberg editor, so you'll get the classic editor,
yeah.
which just means nothing will break, but you won't get to play with it. So you might need to make a new content type or something else that actually gets the editor to load, right? The challenge is always like these older versions are going to need to be updated to recognize that sort of short codes are becoming blocks. They will, whether they will before Gutenberg gets core or not, or how quickly they will, I don't know. Mm-hmm. I feel like the safest immediate thing is to try it on a new site.
Yeah, right? Like a test site for sure.
But if not everybody has a test site, it's just installing it and enabling your site is very unlikely to break anything from a render perspective, right? Because it's not loading the editor, but it's when you go to load the editor, you may get some error that basically says, couldn't load Gutenberg, gave up. Right?
I just don't want
so this is the
front page to be a bunch of short code.
Yeah.
Right. You know, have that mess to deal with.
It's an awkward thing to say, but if you want a quick test
out
of
WordPress,
you can go to poopy.life. It creates a WordPress install on the fly that you can access for a week and improve it. It has this awkward URL, so you don't try to show it to your clients.
It's easier to remember how to spell than Gutenberg.
It is, in fact. So it creates a new WordPress install. You can add plugins to it. So it's just a good way to just like quickly test a couple things. So if you have a copy of Divi, you can throw it up there along with Gutenberg. You can kind of see how they interact.
It's also worth, if you're using a page builder plugin, any of them, following what that page builder plugin's blog is saying about Gutenberg.
Yeah.
This is kind of like, I don't know, dealing with the GDPR, if you deal with Europe, like every provider is giving updates on what they're doing. If they haven't said anything about it by now, that's probably a bad sign. But, you know.
Yeah, this is kind of a time where you'll benefit from doing your homework and using good plugins that are active and updated, because most of the plugins that are maintained and updated have already at least talked about Gutenberg. You know, Yoast, Jetpack, WooCommerce, Divi, Gravity Forms. That, like, just off the top of my head, those are all plugins that have said, hey, We're in the same boat as you guys. We're going to make sure that this is a process ready for you, because you know that it's important to how you use WordPress.
Can you talk about the timeline then? Because it sounds like you talked around it, but not really. Are there dates?
Yeah,
so it's going to be in WordPress 5.0.
But,
When that is, we're not sure yet. So the initial goal was April, I believe.
I think we're going to have a merge proposal by April. So that means feature complete. This thing is ready to get merged into core, and then after that, by the end, it will be a couple months. This is pure speculation.
So when we look at this as an agency, and we're looking at sites that we're building now that are going to launch April and forward. You can either launch with Gutenberg as a plugin, or you can launch completely without Gutenberg and then figure out what you're going to do 3 months later when you have to rebuild everything in Gutenberg. So we're generally nudging clients in the direction of let's build with Gutenberg, recognizing there's going to be a period, maybe that happens in May, maybe it happens in June, maybe it happens in July, there's going to be a period where you're running a plugin on top of core to mimic the direction core is going, but better that than building some alternate road that's going to dead end once core actually figures out what's going on with Gutenberg. Right?
Yeah, and that's what a lot of people did with the REST API too. Mm-hmm. For a while it was in a plugin, and so they were using the plugin until it was version 4.
And I think, you know, the reality is there's going to be a lot of work to do in Gutenberg. So those of us who are developers and code savvy in the room, the more that you can help us squash bugs on Gutenberg as it comes together, the better.
Yeah, the more you build on it, the more bugs you're going to find, the more bugs we can fix.
Exactly. We started by selling it on an internal blog that nobody sees, and then ultimately on the external site, and then a number of people spoke on their personal sites, and then we started experimenting with client sites, right? So kind of experiment on your own things nobody sees first, and then experiment on your things that only a few people see, and then experiment on things that a lot of people see, and you know, ultimately we'll get there.
What else? What do you think? Who wants to share what they think? What do you think so far about?
This is my first shot at it. This is great. So yeah. Thank you. That's part of, I mean, I've, you know, when you see it, you hear it, it's like, at what point do you really have to pay attention versus kind of watch it? So I guess that's the easy question over there is, as you look at teams, is there an issue that your teams like go, oh, we won't be able to do this in Gutenberg? Is there something today that like stops you?
The biggest last one that was remaining is the two columns. Okay. So kind of what we think of as nested blocks or multiple blocks on a line. Before that, everything was kind of stacking, and that was fine for a lot of things, but you know, you want that kind of multi-column look. So that was kind of one of the big last barriers for us, frankly. The way that shared blocks are gonna work and the way that dynamic blocks are gonna work, there's still some stuff we're figuring out there, but we're confident that what we do can translate well into this world. And it more comes down to like the render bugs you get from the way that a theme assumes blocks are going to stack, where like on a lot of the kind of creative that we do, you end up with weird like negative margins and other things to try to break the grid structure. Well, some of that you're going to tweak, right? But like that's fine tuning. That's not fundamental core under the hood broken. That's figuring out how to make it work the way that we want it to work.
I'm also here just retraining. Your team didn't. It's not a hurdle for your team.
No, I mean, we started, like, we had internal presentations at our Hudson at the summer. We've been, you know, we have a lot of people who spend a lot of their time in core and extra camps. And I think for sort of the very first entry, that State of the Word demo at WordCamp this year, which was in December 2017 in Philly, that I think was the thing that opened a lot of people's eyes. And then also Morton DK's talk from WordCamp Philly this year as well, I think was very good.
Nashville.
At Nashville, yes.
Yeah, so this was initially...
It's my hometown.
So Gutenberg was initially shown in WordCamp Europe in June. And then, so a lot of us saw it for the first time there. And then we saw it in December, and we're like, holy cow, it's come a long way. And a lot of people got really excited in December and were able to actually start using it because it had matured a lot. And that was really when I started saying to, you know, Boston University, where we're starting to really look at what's our impact here, how is this going to affect us, and what do we need to do? And instead, now it's far enough along where we can all start to do that as businesses and companies and users. And
yeah, I think start being the key word, right? It's not like you're going to go pick up a book at Barnes & Noble on Gutenberg that's done, because it changes. Even in putting slides together, I noticed like the UI has changed like 3 times in the last 6 months in minor ways. Not fundamentally,
yeah,
just like
tons
tweaks
of minor, tweaks every release. Mm-hmm. So recently I was playing around with, so page templates, kind of terrible in WordPress. You can't preview them. You actually have to publish or update a page to be able to see the template change. Not very fun. And the editor doesn't actually change based on the template you selected. So really, like, in the editor, it doesn't make a difference. So once we introduced templates in Gutenberg, I started looking at ways that you could select one right from the page. So this is just a... This is a first draft. We haven't tested it yet. We haven't really done anything very, very early. So no iterations yet. It's just a mock-up. So you can see just like kind of a representation where it abstracts the blocks on each template. And then when you select it, it actually loads them into the editor. So all you have to do is fill them out.
Do you
want to, if you build it, you can use it tomorrow.
description.
Yeah.
So again, for those of us that haven't researched this, we talk about builders. How is Beaver responding to this? Are they? Is there a future for Beaver?
I'm sure there's some page builders that are like, oh my God, what are we going to do? But then there's some that say, hey, this is our space and we're going to find a way to coexist. And there's really great things here that we can build off of.
Okay.
So yeah, maybe they make page templates like this, or they do something like that.
Or they create a bunch of custom blocks. Yeah. So like, Elementor and Beaver Builder come with a bunch of blocks that aren't included in core.
Right.
And so they're still going to have those blocks. I know that they've been talking about, you know, what to do about Gutenberg. So you're going to see a lot of additional functionality, a lot of additional styling options. So like core itself doesn't necessarily provide a lot of ways to style your content. You know, you might be able to change, let's say, a background color.
And people who are like Mel can design and build custom themes will find ways to work with all these blocks. But a lot of commercial themes that people have purchased won't, at least out of the gate, have good block support. And some of those page builders might have custom blocks that are more attractive, that work better with the theme, that integrate better, that have best practices around like optimization testing and like best practices around what kind of blocks might be on the landing page, that kind of stuff.
Yeah. So it's hard to see it here, but it has a background color behind it. So there's gonna be some like minor styling things like colors, but I expect page builders are gonna wanna include their own fonts that you can change out. They're gonna wanna include a lot of them allow you to change margins and padding. It's not seeing that happen in core. So definitely something that would fall down to a page builder plugin to use. I think there's definitely a lot of additional functionality in building they can do on Gutenberg that still makes them financially viable. There's at least one page builder that was like, this is what I was trying to do, and it's a free plugin, and I'm done. Yeah. Ported it for me, and that was Taylor, which was a good little plugin. But the people that are making money off of their page builders have the incentive to make it work. And I do also think that like the people who end up being first to market with some of their like themes and plugins that are Gutenberg compatible are going to end up making some good cash.
Can you point to some? I mean, who should we be watching?
So Yoast, absolutely, is doing a lot of good work. I would see, I don't know if Debbie's posted anything on her blog, but I would look at their blog and Beaver Builder's blog to see if they've said anything.
I think they saw it tonight at Beaver Builder, said they were in the Gutenberg camp.
Nice.
I imagine Genesis is, on the right path.
I haven't heard anything from Genesis specifically.
Press.
I would assume so, but I don't want to tell you yes or no because I'm not 100% sure.
Gutenberg is Facebook? I don't know what that means. Anyway, they are talking about it.
Gutenberg is WordPress's Facebook to MySpace.
Yeah, great, thank you.
Exactly.
Yeah, Alchemist. So in the case of like the example of that template for books post-op, where you have a field for the author, is there like a framework or API to have that mapped to a post meta?
Yeah, great question. So that you define that when you register a post type. And you basically list the blocks in the order that you want to show up. Mm-hmm. And then this would all get saved into the actual post content. So remember when I said that everything is HTML comments? It's basically in the editor. But then, Mel, how does it get separated out when they're shared?
I don't know any of the technical implementations.
So I understand that the API is stored in a post content, but what if you want to have that author field to have that stored as a separate post meta?
Right. Because somewhere else you want to have a widget that lists out recent books, or because you want to have
You want to like query for like all books that are.
Yeah, that's a great question. you could still have a meta field for it, mm-hmm. and you could still display it somewhere, and maybe you have a block that displays a taxonomy list. So, right.
So one thing you could explore is you can turn off Gutenberg for certain post types. Mm-hmm. So you might have a custom post type that's more like this is. So one of the challenges, like meta boxes, and this gets a little meta, like meta boxes partially were about actually doing structured data. So mm-hmm. post types that really were separate data types and had very structured data fields about them and wanted a different kind of experience. And meta boxes were sort of about changing the appearance and moving stuff around on the screen. Gutenberg is addressing the latter, not so much the former, right? So I'm not sure that a Gutenberg editor is the best place to create a structured entry form for 300 books. It is the best place to then pull a block into a page somewhere else that lists some of those recent books, right?
But, yeah.
So it's not like, I don't know that we'll necessarily see Gutenberg used for every kind of editing you do in WordPress. I guess that's my gut reaction, is like some of those really structured data types might still make sense of staff profile. Like, it might still make sense to have a staff directory that's a custom post type where some of that entry, maybe it's still a Gutenberg editor, but it's not really about moving the blocks around. It's really about filling out these things.
Yeah, and then it turns into a block that you put on your right. team page.
Because what you don't want to do is, in the restaurants example, is have 300 different places where people are putting hours for that one place in different places in the database. You want that in one place, and then you want to pull it into display.
And you could always have a block that is just one field that searches another post type and inserts it, and it's formatted a certain way. So you could have the book, just a list of fields that they fill in, doesn't actually have Gutenberg, and then you have a block that would pull that post type in, that data in, yeah.
So is it sort of data you want to put in a structured fashion into a page, mm-hmm. or is it data you're really modeling that belongs elsewhere in the database? And then figuring out what the right editing approach is based on those choices, right? I think would be a big part of it. Like, I'd hate to run a book site if everything was just being stored as HTML comments and wasn't actually available in PostMeta. If it was in HTML content for rendering and was in PostMeta for database storage, then I'd be upset.
Another example there is, so there's the custom menu widget where you can display a menu inside of a widget. And so our first iteration on that block, it's just a drop-down of all your existing menus. So you would make the menu in the menu editor, and then if you wanted to show the menu in your post to your page, you would drop in the menu block, and then via the drop-down, select the menu that you just made. So in that case, create it elsewhere, display it here. And ideally, we'd like to be able to like create a menu from inside, you know, a page, but that's it's just so much easier and faster to get out of V1 in that case. Yes, this is the column mark.
What's the black gear on the top right?
Yeah, so this hides and shows the sidebar.
I see. Okay. And so the three dots, the
some additional editor options.
Come on, so menu.
Yeah. You can switch between visual and code editor. The fixed toolbar to top setting, so that I think it just made that sticky. Oh no, actually, here's what it is. Yeah, so rather than the inline toolbar, you get it at the very top of your screen.
That's the toolbar that applies to that block. Yeah.
So you can see in the middle here, too, this is a block that it thinks is old content. So this is an example of something you might see if you activate it on an old post. You activate it on your site, you edit an old piece of content.
What would you do if you saw that block? What button would you
hit? She just chose overwrite, I think, which is the Gutenberg version now, because now it's been translated, but if it had been edited in like the code editor, you went in and tweaked a short code or something, Gutenberg might get confused and might give you that message.
So
if the old version, you get the old version. If you chose the right, you get the new version.
The changes are still stored in revision, so if you break something, you can still run back to a previous version of your post. So in this case, I think it didn't like the fact that I started making columns, then I switched to the HTML editor, and then I did some stuff, and then it was like, wait, what was this? Which I think I've seen before, and it's probably a bug in this year.
Probably shouldn't have you do that. Yes.
Oh, this is another one. So if you want to copy your whole post, there's a tool in the more menu where you can just copy all content.
And you might, like, if you do want to play with testing, you might want to do that. You might duplicate a post and play with an unpublished one, right? Because then you can preview and muck around with it without breaking it. Even though you could go back to revisions. Make destructive copies anyway. So, okay.
Is there anyone who's jumped out and done really good training already? Any sites that you'd point to?
Zach Gordon?
Yes, Zach Gordon.
Yeah. Zach Gordon has lots of stuff out there already. Awesome guy. He does great training. I forget what he calls his training site, though, but definitely look him up.
He's one of the few WordPress training providers we pay to take his classes.
Wow, cool.
There's also documentation somewhere. Thought it was here, but I guess.
So WordPress.org/Gutenberg is a great place to start, and then it's got a bunch of references, but like there's no make.wordpress.org specific to Gutenberg. It's a focus within core, so you have to kind of dig around in the blog to find the updates, but they regularly update when they do releases.
Yeah, they do a post almost every week. In a version every week, right? No? Are they still doing that every week?
When it makes sense.
Yeah.
Yeah, see, so it says development updates on make.wordpress.org, but I think it just takes you to the core.
So you asked about reactions earlier. Mm-hmm. I know for my site, my users have just a single, I only give my users a single HTML block.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm going to do a thing on how to make this not go into effect. It just sounds like a training nightmare for me.
So there are lots of ways to do that. There's a plugin already called Gluten Free. There will be ways to turn that off for post types, for users, based on roles and capabilities. So you'll have lots of options for that. I think what may get more frustrating is if your users use WordPress elsewhere, or hear about WordPress elsewhere, they might start saying, how come I didn't get all that shiny new hotness? If they don't, then they will probably never know. But.
Yeah, but I mean, like, users across the web know how to use a standard HTML widget, like a super standard. This is like super not standard. Like, I totally get the appeal, and I like it for other stuff, but just for like, hey, just do this simple thing, that's like,
yeah, well, I think it's a question of the right editor for the right time for the right user, right? Like, we've always talked about casual users who rarely log into your CMS versus people who spend 10 hours a day staring at the dashboard.
Absolutely.
Very different use cases, very different needs. Like, you could build, I mean, there are people who build front-end post editors, there are people who build, you can still post by email, right? There's lots of simple ways to do posting. It's more, I think, for the editors who are, and maybe it's because we spend a lot of time dealing with media and publishing and digital marketing companies, but they are expecting a lot more out of their editor than just a plain type of paragraphs.
Yeah,
they're expecting to do a lot more.
You can also limit which blocks are available by post type, I believe. And I know it was talked about, but I don't know if it's in there yet, is limiting the number of a block per, like only three images, only two paragraphs, whatever it might be. So those are other options too. You might have just that one HTML block that you let allow.
Do your users do low embeds today, or do they put images in?
That's about it.
Yeah. So you could also consider deregistering any block that isn't the one that you want them to use.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So it was just like a data point. I actually think it's really great. And so on my sales side, I use a Zigzag Press plugin. I know it's it was like insanely obtuse. And it looks great coming out, but like trying to go through, the hoops that they obviously went through to get the layout reasonable, that was like, it's crazy. This would be, tough for them, but it feels like, you get a theme, and then it looks like actually quite useful.
If you're like a marketer wanting to spin up 10 different landing pages a month for different kinds of campaigns and stuff that aren't showing up at the menu anywhere, but have different layout and have different content in them. This kind of thing is really helpful.
And
that's
it'll be even more helpful once we start building out more dynamic blocks and more things related to layout, which is going to be after the initial release, so more like 5.1, 5.2. So there is a bunch of documentation. In the docs folder on my plugin. Is this on GitHub? So if you go to github.com/wordpress/Gutenberg, you can look for the docs folder.
That's really good work.
blocks are also built in a way that they're very easily extendable. So if you want to remove the center option on paragraph for whatever reason, or if you want to add colors or add a button to a certain block, it's built really well and really well thought out in a way that you can very easily do that. So that's another great part of this, is that we have these standardized areas and tools on these blocks that we can very easily add things to and subtract things from that will help with that.
Could actually give them a simpler interface than the default.
Yeah.
Oh, you could always make, you would have been able to customize that.
Maybe I should have rephrased my reaction as intimidated.
Yeah.
Not for me personally, but for information.
Do you want to comment on React? I mean, has that been a hard challenge or transition for people? Or?
So I know the people that initially worked on the project were very well versed in React, and I know a lot of people, I haven't personally dove in yet, but I know a lot of people that have actually found it less intimidating than they thought. So I definitely encourage you to, if it's something you're thinking about, definitely take the dive in and check it out.
Was it State of the Road 2016 Learn JavaScript Deeply?
Yeah.
Calypso and all that, right? Like this has been...
15?
2015, so. I lose track. It was a long time ago. The WordPress community has been telegraphing Learn JavaScript for a long time in various ways. React has become very popular as the framework. I know we have, if you look back at the version compare slider that came out in 4.2 or whatever that Silverstein built, it's all built in Backbone. Our team has picked up React a lot faster than Backbone, frankly, right? Which is also in core and used in some of the backend stuff. So I'm actually happy to see React used, because I think that will actually cause less headaches than Backbone did for us.
It's also where the general space is gravitating towards, too, is JavaScript frameworks. And so it's not going to be something that you're only going to use on WordPress. If you have other outside projects that don't use WordPress, you probably benefit a lot from it, too. So from a developer standpoint, there's multiple areas of benefit from doing it. It's just, for me, it's just been a time thing. I haven't actually gotten to dive in yet.
Just another layout example. From
Mike
Hill, the head developer of the project. Just fill in the blank. And so you can imagine, you know, if you're setting up a premium theme, you know, rather than having to either import content or use a bunch of shortcodes, you just open up a new page and, like, this is there by default. And you just fill it in.
Anybody else have anything else they want to add? Anything at all?
Good session.
All right, very good. Thank you, guys.